you're okay with us recording this? It's a PDF, so I guess.
Response. I mean, who will respond? Okay, I mean, And I would say that very promptly, okay, I mean not, so you have, okay, so this is like, the name of the software is Quantum Espresso, and it is free, and you can go to their webpage, and then you can download the thing, right, on this tab, right, and then there is a very detailed documentation, okay, that what is what, and also the tutorial videos, tutorial slides, etc. Okay, everything is available, so it is fairly well documented. And then there are a few softwares, right, like which is as popular as this, for example, Vast, but then for Vast you have to pay some license fee, that is not free, and maybe like Siesta and maybe a few others. Okay. But in our group, we mainly use right this one, right, because it's free and it's almost as good as the paid software, the licensed software. Okay, so let me just try to explain that what we need to, how can we start modeling solid, right, starting from the atomic level, and then let us at least try to understand what are the difficulties. This is not, it sounds very simple that okay, we'll start from atomic level, but then I'll just explain that I'm going to show that it is not that simple. Okay. And all these things were developed around like by the time, like all these things, right? Whatever I'm going to show in the next 2-3 slides, these things were developed by 1930s or so. They were going on. For example, right, we know that there is a solid, right? It is made up. So you have a nucleus. And you have electrons, right? And there are many of them, right? And how many of them? Avogadro's number, right? 6.0. Right? Okay. And if I want to solve everything, then what is happening? At some finite temperature, I have nucleus, which is moving, right? Which is vibrating around some given position. And I have electrons, which are like going around the nucleus. And then I also have to consider the electron-electron interaction. I have to consider the electron-nucleus. So this is like the kinetic energy of the electron. The kinetic energy of the nucleus. This is the electron-electron interaction. The electron-ion interaction, and then I have ion. So these are like potential energies, right? All the these are potential energies, ion-ion interactions. So we have like all these different types of interactions, and I have a number which is on the order of 8.73. Okay, so this is a big challenge. Okay, so now the first round of simplification was done in the following way, that since the nuclei, right, they are like 3 to 4 orders of magnitude heavier than electrons, right? So by the time they move from this place to the some place, right, the electron will go around it like many times, okay? And you see the frequency ratio is 50, right? So this is, the electrons, they move much faster than nucleus, right? So the nucleus, I can just assume it to be quasi-static, right? As if it is not moving, right? As if it is fixed, and the electrons are moving around it, okay? So ionic motions are ignored because they are much heavier than electrons, that's what I said just now. And this is known as the famous Born-Oppenheimer approximation, that I just need to solve this part, right? But still I cannot ignore the kinetic energy of the electrons, electron-electron interaction, and electron-ion interaction. I'll just assume that the ions are not moving that fast. So they are like quasi-static, right? Your task for the moment. Or in the first approximation, right? And then you can just write the kinetic energy, right, of the electron. This is directly from quantum mechanics, right, the basic quantum mechanics, right. This is how you write this. And like, so we just write d2 dx square in case of 1D, right. In case of 3D, this becomes just this, right, gradient square. Okay, and electron-electron interaction, this just depends on the distance between the two electrons, right. This is just the Coulomb potential, right, nothing else. And this is again the Coulomb potential, one electron ion, and then you have a minus sign, that means this is attractive, right? So I knew that what are the three. I can at least write down, right, the quantum mechanical or the operator, right, or three things, right? The kinetic energy of electron, electron-electron interaction, and electron-ion interaction. Okay. And now I have to write down the wave function. Okay. And then there is something called the scatter determinant, which obeys, right, Pauli's exclusion principle, Hund's rule, etc. And then you have a n by n scatter determinant. And then you can just put them here. And what do we do in quantum mechanics, right? We try to calculate expectation values, right? This is my wave function, right? For one particle, this is much simpler, right? And now I have some wave function which is like 3n dimensional. And I put it there. And I try to calculate expectation values, etc. And you see that already the problem is, it gets very difficult, okay? And then you see, as I said, that right, things were known, right, by 1930. Okay. So what Thomas and Fermi, what they did is the following, right? They suggested that, and this is like almost a classical model, okay, of trying to solve that problem, okay, that three-dimensional problem. Okay. So they just said that, okay, I can express everything, right? The electron, the kinetic energy, the electron-ion interaction, electron-electron interaction, I can express everything in terms of electron density. So that's what they proposed. And the only quantum mechanical thing is that is there in the model is that all states, so you know, right, when you do, right, I mean, all states are to the Fermi energy, or I can calculate the Fermi momentum, those things are three, right? And then uncertainty principle that only two electrons can occupy this much of volume in the free space. So these are the only two things that the rest of the model is completely classical, right? You see that this equation, right? This is like classical Coulomb energy, right? And this is the Hartree. This is called the Hartree potential, and this is again classical, right? So they didn't do anything. I mean, this model is like almost classical, and we have some quantum thing which is there in the kinetic energy of the electrons, but again, that is like not fully quantum. So fine. And then, what is the main outcome from, what is the main message that we can get from here is, energy can be expressed as a function of electron density. Okay, so this is, and electron density is a three-dimensional variable, right? So instead of trying to struggle or trying to juggle with three-dimensional variable, right? I can do everything in terms of electron density, which is just a three-dimensional function. Okay, fine. So these are the key steps noted here. So the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, right? This is this. And ideally, right, what one should do is try to write, try to calculate every term by putting this scatter determinant over there. But then this is very difficult because this is a 3n-dimensional function. And the alternate method is to express energy as a function of electron density. That will make life much simpler. And this was first implemented in Thomas Fermi model. Okay. And then, as I said, that by 1930, people knew that, okay, we can solve things quantum mechanically, but we need a practical method to do so, which can be easily implemented and used by easy data. Okay, so that is what was lacking. And this gentleman, right, he came up with some idea in 1964, where he actually showed that, okay, you can actually get some ground state, etc., right, starting from the electron density. And Walter Cohn had received Nobel Prize in chemistry for this development of DFT in 1998. Okay. So, now what is different from Thomas Fermi? Okay. Okay, the difference between this and Thomas Fermi is the following, right? So this is again, right, I mean, we are calculating the kinetic energy here quantum mechanically, right, by trying to calculate this state algorithm, his expectation value. And this is also again, this is the classical Kolmogorov interaction. And then you see that there are many unknown terms, right? For example, this is the actual kinetic energy, right? Whereas I am calculating only this, right? And this is the actual electron-electron interaction, right? The many-body thing, right? Which takes into account all these quantum mechanical things. And this is the Hartree potential, which is again classical. So you see that all the unknown terms, right? You can put it and define it as exchange correlation, right? Once you do that, then everything is done, right? Then what we are doing is that we are mapping that whole this many-body problem to something like effective one particle Hamiltonian, right? Where the effect due to all the other particles are put in this term somehow. So the challenge is to find this term, and in this term everything is defined, right? If you know the ionic positions, right? The position of nucleus, you can just calculate the interaction of nucleus and the electron, right? Very easily. That is what this term is, and this is the classical electron-electron interaction, right? So everything is fine. So the only challenge is to find this, and then people figure out how to do that by some approximation, and that's where the lies the weakness of this model, etc., which I will not go into the detail, right? So this is what the model is. So now this is the DFT flowchart, okay? And again, this is a self-consistent problem. Okay, so what we are doing? We have to start with some guess. So we are not dealing with the wave function anymore. We know that everything can be expressed as a function of electron density. Okay? And now once you know the electron density, you can calculate the potential, the effective potential, right? That's what we go into my equation, right? So this is the interaction of electrons and ions, right? And I know rho r, right? This at every point, that means I can calculate this term, okay? And there is some approximation, which is the weakness. That's what I mentioned, but just assume that if someone gives me rho r, I can calculate this. That's the weakness, right, of DFT. But anyway, that is fine. So I can calculate the effective potential if I have the initial guess, okay? And in most of the codes, right, the initial guess is taken to be the density of free electrons. That works fine, okay? And then once I have this term, then I solve this. This is the solving the Schrodinger equation, right? These are called the Kolmogorov equations, but then these are like actually solving the, this is same as solving the Schrodinger equation, right? Once I know this. And then once I solve the equation, then I get the wave function, okay, which is like phi I r. From there, I again calculate the electron density by taking mod of I square. And now I check whether this density and this density, whether they are same or not. If they are same, then it is converged. If they are not same, then I again go back to this step. Okay, so using this rho r, I again calculate the potential, I again solve the Kolmogorov equation, I again calculate the density, and I keep doing this as long as my initial, as long as the whatever goes here and whatever comes out from this, they are not almost very close to each other. Okay, you can always set your convergence criteria, etc. Okay, so that's how this looks. That's how DFT works. Okay, once you have this, the converged electron density, then I can calculate the band structure. Right? I hope all of you know what is band structure. Right? This is like E versus K. We can calculate the effective mass, which is related to second derivative of the E versus K. We can calculate charge density, which is this times the, this is, and we already have it, right? And we can calculate mobility using some approximation, etc., right? So, once we get the electron density in a self-consistent way, we can get many useful things from this formalism. Okay, so this is the flowchart for this multi-scale modeling, right? This is the dream, right? This is what you should be, this is what one should be able to do, right? This is the dream, right? And you start from a material, use DFT, right? And then what you have to do is that you have to do, like, you have to find the optimized crystal structure, right? And once you know that, once you know the electron density, then you can find the electronic gas structure, you can find the density of states, you can find the electric mass, you can find electron density, you can find dielectric constant, you can find carrier mobility, and so on. Okay, and we use these quantities for your compact model, right? Which you got some idea about what you can do, right? From this thing, right? So, of course, I am not going to detail that, how can you use this to do some compact modeling, that is outside the scope of my talk, but you already got some idea from the previous lecture, right? So this is what you can do, and this is a multi-scale model. You start from atoms and electrons, and you end up modeling a device. Okay, so this is the dream. So okay, fine. So story so far is advantages of DFT. This is more accurate. Right? There are other models, like, which are approximate models, like time-bending models. DFT is more accurate than those things. Okay, and this is nevertheless, right? This is like effective one electron approach, right? So I have a many electron problem, which has a very complicated looking wave function, but I manage to one electron problem. That's what is the beauty of DFT. Okay, and this is very successful on metals, DFT, and this is fairly successful for semiconductors. There are issues of band gap restriction. Okay, and what are the limitations? These are highly expensive calculations. Okay, and then nowadays there are all these two-dimensional materials, which I will show a few results from two-dimensional materials. And in two-dimensional materials, right, they are made together by Van der Waals impressions, and it is difficult to handle VDW, Van der Waals impressions, but there are ways to do it. So it's not that big limitation. And then there is the other things like band gap underestimation. But again, there are ways to work on that. So this is not that serious. But of course, this is true, right? And you need a very, you need very powerful computers. Okay, you cannot just do things in a laptop. Okay, so now what I will do is that I will show some results, right, which we obtained, right, in our group only. Okay, and then I will also show you some one small example that the input file, right, that is what goes there in the calculation, right, that you can have some idea, like, how easy or how difficult it is to do the DFT calculation. Okay. So, I think more about this graphene, right? This is a wonder material in 2004, right? I mean, it revolutionized, right, the research on 2D materials, right? So, it has many fantastic properties. Okay, so now just assume that I want to do a, I have to calculate the electronic gas structure on the field using my software, right? Using the quantum system. Okay, that's a specific example here. Yeah? Then what do I need to do? Okay, I mean, I just need to have, so this is how many lines, like, it's like maybe 20 lines, okay. That's the input file, okay, that's all. So what is there in the input file? Okay, this is some technical thing, so let's ignore that. And this is again some technical thing, so let me show you the unit cell of graphene. So this is the unit cell of graphene, right? So this, I mean, you see this mark here, right? And then you have two atoms per unit cell. Okay, so I have to. So that's what it says, right? N is number of atoms, 2, n type is equal to 1, and this is like plain wave code, so you have to. This is again some technical thing, so you can know that. And then this is again some technical thing, right? This is like K point image, etc. And now you see that there is something called this. This is called a pseudo potential file. I will come back to that, what it is. And there is something, now I have to define the thing itself.
And how it is defined?
It is defined by mentioning these two vectors,
right?
And you see that this vector, this is along the x-axis and this is the second vector, and this vector is along this axis. And you see that I have to define, so because these DFT codes, they are made for 3D things, right? You have to do some trick, right? You have to trick it to do your 2D calculations, and the trick is to make the cell vector in the third dimension so large that effectively there is no interaction between layers, right? That's why you see that the third cell vector, this is almost like 10 times larger than this. Okay? So that's how you can do. That's how you can run 2D simulations, and then you just mention, right, there are two atoms, so you have to mention their position. Okay, that's all. Okay. Now, this part is not, it will not be there in every code. Okay? It depends on how you are doing the calculations. Okay. So these are called these are called pseudo potentials. So what they are? So you know that the properties they are mainly dictated by the valence electrons.
Okay. Yeah. Almost.
Okay. So they are dictated by valence electrons, right? So what we do is that we model, right, some approximate function that tells you that defines the potential from core as well as the nucleus as well as the core electron. So that's what is this file doing. And then you can also download the pseudo potentials from your website. You can, for regular users, you can even generate these things yourselves. That is for expert users. Okay. And once you are done with that, this is the billowing zone. These are the high symmetry points in the K space. And then this is the band structure for graphene. You see the Dirac point, and this is the density of the state, right? So that's the output from. You have to do one more step to get this, but that is roughly what it is. Okay. And now I will show some. What are the things that we can do using graphene? So it's also using the DFT software. So we can predict new materials. So this was done in our group, that we predicted a new material which looks like a graphene but which is actually a semiconductor. We can also study magnetism, right? This was again done in our group, and then you see that this is the next level, right? So once we define, once we get the electron density and ground state, etc., right? We can actually run Monte Carlo code to get the transition temperature, right? There is a like, for example, iron, right? The transition temperature is roughly 950, right? Beyond which it becomes a paramagnet, right? So for every magnetic material, there is a transition temperature. So similarly, right, we can calculate those things from the input or from the data generated from DFT. And this is another 2D material. Again, this was done in our group. Okay, and this is like a 2D material made of phosphorus instead of carbon, right? And okay, this is not very clear, but these are the band structures. And these materials are highly anisotropic, etc. And we also calculated the mobility. This is directly from DFT. Okay, we calculated the mobility of this is the mobility of one of the allotropes, right, that I showed in the previous lecture. And you can calculate the mobility using DFT, and this is again a bilayer of the alpha phosphorus or black phosphorus, right? You see that there are two layers, and this is the electronic band structure, the density of states. Again, this was done by a student, right? And then you can calculate the dielectric constant. How do you do that? You just apply the electric field. Right, and these are the layers in the electric field in the vertical direction. And then you see that once you apply the electric field, right, the charge densities are going to be redistributed. Right, and from that charge density redistribution, we can actually calculate all these things. Okay, so that's what it is. Okay, so now, so this is the last slide. So this is a take home. Message is like the device simulation, this is a multi-cell process, right? And this has to be a multi-scale model, right? And then at the atomic length scale, the things are dictated by laws of quantum mechanics. And then there are parameter-based models. They are very effective, but they have limitations. And these are the limitations of DFT is these are computationally very expensive. But one, if you can afford that, right, then using DFT we can get many important parameters which can be used as input for your compact models. Okay, thank you. And if you have any questions, sure, sir. Yes.
How do we
what documents?
Relaxation. For the DFT calculation, we have to give